Greater Reading ACT UP on BCTV is supported by the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theatres.
Hello, hello, welcome, and Happy New Year, everyone. Hi, this is Pat Perfect, your hostess for Greater Reading ACT UP. And I want to introduce you to a new friend of mine. So we just sort of became friends before the New Year's, and looking forward to working with her. She's going to be involved with the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters, and her name is Lori Galley.
Hi, Pat.
Hi, Lori. How are you? Nice to see you.
Yes, thank you. You too. Thanks for hosting me today.
Well, Happy New Year to you.
Yes.
So, I mentioned about how you're helping GRACT out and stuff. Maybe you want to talk a little bit about that, or maybe you want to tell everybody a little bit about yourself and being a Berks Countyan.
Sure, I'd love to. So, as Pat said, my name is Lori D'Onofrio Galley. And I've spent many years working in the nonprofit sector in Berks and Lancaster counties. I live in Spring Township with my husband. He and I, Richard and I, have three children, Tessa, Emma, and David. We actually have a child who's still in middle school at Wilson West. We live in Spring Township. We also have a senior dog and a brand new granddaughter who'll be 1 year old on January 29th. So we are very excited this year to have a new addition to our family. Pat, I am a native of Berks County. I grew up in Wyomissing. I graduated in the class of 1979. And most of my life I've lived in Berks, and for about 11 years we lived in Lancaster County years ago. My husband and I met at Elizabethtown College when we were freshmen in 1979. So we've been together for a long time, 42 years.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, that is nice. Recently, I started my own business, something that was always a driving force in the back of my mind for many decades. And I started on April 30th, the Right Angle Strategic Storytelling. And I'm a PR strategist. Prior to starting my own business, I worked for 23 years in nonprofit management. I'm sure you'll recognize some of these names. I worked for Berks Women in Crisis, now Safe Berks. I worked for Aaron's Acres. My first nonprofit administrative role was at the Winters Heritage House Museum in Elizabethtown, and I worked there for 16 years. And most recently, I was the executive director of the Northeast Berks Chamber in Kutztown, and that was for 6 years before starting my own business. I had met some of the partners, I'll say, and board members of Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters, just coincidentally, in the last few months. And then I was invited to interview. I was so honored, Pat, to be invited to interview for a consultant role. And thankfully, after that interview, you hired me. So I'm very, very pleased and happy to support the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters, and most importantly, to help you advance your strategic initiatives.
Yes, we're very happy you joined us, Lori. I think you were a real go-getter. You were starting to work before you even needed to, and that was really wonderful of you.
Yeah, sure.
We're looking forward to some good things happening, aren't we?
We absolutely are. I think it's very relevant that I had leadership roles at four nonprofit organizations leading up to this consulting project. And I served as both executive director twice, and I was a development director twice. So I have experience managing nonprofit organizations. And so not only was I honored to be invited to interview, but I was also very excited about the scope of work, because certainly business development, marketing, public relations, Those are all areas of expertise and experience that I've had over these years. And I want to say too that when I was in high school in the 70s, you know, for example, Genesius was very popular. There were students in my high school class and other grades who were actively involved in those theater productions. So I've been familiar with the local theater scene for many decades.
Yeah, I know. You seem to have a good handle on things and know a lot of people in the community. So we're really hoping that with your guidance and help, we'll be able to achieve some of our goals and get more community involvement in looking for a venue and a dream theater for everyone to perform in different groups around the county. So it's a big job.
Well, you know, collaboration is so important. And I know that from my years of working in nonprofit organizations. And when you think about people like yourself and the other board members who tirelessly give to the association as volunteers, and you see that certainly in other nonprofits, you have volunteer boards and you have other community volunteers that support the mission of an organization. And you have a nice network of people who are not only involved in some of the member theater groups, but also as partners in the community. And I think it's wonderful that now you're looking at the membership, even expanding beyond the area theater groups, but also other performing arts and also business people as well.
Yeah, no, I think that that's been something that maybe we've been missing for a while is that, there's only a few theaters in Reading, really. And to have a community theater and want everyone to participate or have the ability to participate and stuff really means opening up to other groups and organizations. So, I hope that we can bring in enough folks that generate the interest to help us find this venue that everybody seems to need. So I think you might be a busy girl in the next four or 5 months.
Yeah, I expect to be busy. And of course, a dream venue is a priority. And also the benefits that your group has really developed over the last few years. As part of association membership, because naturally, I think there will be a cost savings involved. We have so many, I'll say, smaller nonprofits in the city of Reading, performing arts and others, and all of those groups need cost-effective resources. And I think that's what your group has really designed for membership, is that the cost-effective nature of participating, the collaboration, and yet each group can keep its artistic identity.
Yes, that's important because like you were talking about Genesius and Reading Community Players, Reading Civic Theater, which used to be Reading Civic Opera, they all have their own identities and a lot of audience members that follow them in the county and look forward to their performances, recognizing the quality entertainment they're going to see.
We really do have outstanding talent here in the Reading Berks County area, and I think that's been the case for many years, despite the fact that we're not a larger metropolitan area like Philadelphia. We just have an enormous amount of talent. You know, as you said, there are a few groups, maybe five or six groups in the area, and that's pretty impressive for, you know, a smaller region.
Yeah, it is. We've been hoping to go outside of the area, directly the city, like to First Street Players. They're from Birdsboro. And of course, up in Pottstown, they have like a theater group that involves like three different organizations, I believe. And also then out in, I think, Boyertown, they have an interesting arts organizations out there, different things. So we'll see what happens. We're having a gathering, a get together meeting, informational meeting on Saturday, January 8th at Doubletree, and Lori's going to be attending, and hopefully you'll see some good things happening there and meet some old friends that you've known around the community and stuff, because they've been invited.
Yes. And, you know, based on what you're telling me about attendance, you have a very promising attendance. I think that's promising for the group that you're getting that interest for this early meeting in the year.
Yeah, I'm hoping that, I mean, it's a little concerning right now. I know people are thinking seriously about how much contact folks want to have with the change in the virus, how it's Omicron now or whatever. And so people are circumspect about what they want to do, but we're going to be a Doubletree. It's a very safe environment, I think. We're going to have a nice large room, plenty of space for people, and wear masks, take care of ourselves, and have an informative meeting like with the other board members who've been working on presentations that we're going to offer our guests, and see, hopefully they consider perhaps joining us, and we'll collaborate and work together. And that's a big part of what GRACT wants to be, the Alliance wants to be.
Yeah, well, I look forward to working with you to move your organization, you know, in the direction of its vision. That's very exciting and historic, I think, too.
Yeah, it would be historic if we could get everybody together and work together. It certainly would be. So now, what sort of things do you think are going to be helpful that we'll be able to help you do?
Well, I always appreciate expanding my network. You know, I found that through my work, especially in the nonprofit sector, and now in the last 9 months of my own business, one of the greatest assets for any person or organization is the network. And so I hope to both expand my own network, but also help you expand your network with the relationships that I've fostered over the years, because those partnerships will bring other resources to the organization. And getting to know people, you know, it's interesting when you're from Berks County, you always feel that you know everybody, everywhere you go. Either you know the person or they know people that you know. So we're pretty well connected, but I've already started to, informally interview some people who are associated with your alliance and also some of the other groups. And it's really interesting for me to understand how people got involved in these groups and what role they play. And again, Pat, how long have you been involved in the theater community?
Oh, my goodness. Ever since I was a grown-up. When I was a kid, I was involved in the theater. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't until, you know, after being an adult and having the opportunity and ability to be able to transport yourself around, because as a kid, you know how you have to rely on mom and dad all the time.
Yes.
So, going into ours, we used to have a theater at 11th and Buttonwood. We had that in 1962 is when they had their first show there. And unfortunately, we had to sell it in 2015. Because the building was falling into disrepair and we couldn't spend enough money to keep it going. But I've been involved with Reading Community Players for at least 50, 60 years. I hate to admit.
That is amazing.
Yeah. Friend and teacher, Betty Lou McLean, was a director there. And she also worked with her husband, Bruce McLean, over at the Reading Civic Opera, and their wonderful musicals that they created. And she was a director at RCP, so I had a role. I don't know if it was one of those things that the director just sort of gives you as a gift. It was a small role, but anyway, that was my beginning at the theater downtown. So we miss it a lot. Anyone that doesn't have a theater, a place to be for rehearsals, and building sets and taking, you know, we really miss that. And it's a challenge for any director to find a venue somewhere in Reading. And we do like to stay in Reading. We would like to find a building or a facility where we can continue to serve the community in the city. But we'll have to see. We keep looking. So
I think it will happen. And, you know, like history and, you know, other things, theater helps to build community. It's been a stronghold in the city of Reading. It's part of its heritage, as you're, you know, demonstrating for many, many decades. So yeah. I think that's important. That will help to bring the audiences. I believe, you know, the members will, as I said, benefit from resources that they may not have now, help them to save money and perhaps build some kind of a infrastructure to really keep it going and continue to introduce young people into the programs.
Yeah, it's a lot easier when you have your own theater to work with young people that way, because not everybody is interested necessarily on being on stage, but we have so many other things in the theater that require help and work and people, like costumes and props and lighting and sets, that we could work with young people and teach them what we know, share our skills and our training.
Yes.
We do have people in our group that are educated, trained theater people, whatever you want to call it. So we need a community theater. Everybody, I'm a broken record about that. And anybody who knows me knows that that's like my mantra, you know, we need a community theater. So I'm so excited about you working with us, you know.
Oh, thank you. I'm
really
excited too.
Your blessing.
Oh, you're sweet, Pat. Thank you.
So, have you always just like kind of gone to theaters, or have you ever participated in theater? Or
I've never acted or sung or participated in a production. My daughter was very active in the Wilson Theater Company at Wilson School District. Her name is Emma, and she's 27 now, but she was both a performer and she worked behind the scenes as well. So we would see all of those productions, of course. And, but myself, I've never, of course, I've attended productions, but I, and I'm not a shy person. You already know that about me, but I, it's funny. If I think about performing or auditioning for something, I think I would feel shy about that for some reason, even though I love speaking in front of people, I can run meetings, but I don't know if I could do it. I don't know.
I don't know. You interviewed very well. That's what I remember. You made yourself, you know, very warm and friendly and approachable. So I have trouble imagining that you wouldn't be able to pull that off on stage.
I can imagine that it takes several months, you know, to really get that part down. How many months typically do you prepare for production? Is it 3 or 4?
Well, you know, that's an interesting question because it's different for every group.
Okay.
When we used to have our own theater back in the old days, a production would go in for 6 weeks. So you had 6 weeks before you opened.
That's fast.
It is. Reading Civic Theater now, historically, they do 2 shows a year. And they start their auditions and rehearsals and productions, and they go on for months before they open and stuff. I believe a lot of that is because you're talking music, dance, and theater. So it's quite a strenuous rehearsal schedule because everybody's got to get coordinated that way as far as like dancing and the music and everything else that all works together. I always thought that they have a rather arduous task that way, but that takes several months. And some of the other theater groups, like Genesius, I think, they do pretty much 6 to 8 weeks of rehearsal too, Of course, you know, COVID has probably changed a lot of what people do, how long it takes, and safe distancing and wearing masks at rehearsal and things like that. I know for any kind of professional or equity production, everybody has to be vaccinated and wear masks. So it's different now after COVID. It's made a change. So I know with some of the shows that we wanted to do in 2019, that had to wait until 2020 sometime. And we didn't really open up, what, till like May this past year?
Right.
Yeah, so those people, I think, were probably doing a lot of Zoom rehearsals.
Right. I'm sure there probably were some virtual productions. I don't know. Were there?
Well, Debbie Silas did a kids production, which was a fun show. It was about, can't remember, it's a lengthy title. It's something about happy, awesome, happy, everyday good news. It was a good news story where the kids all shared good things about what they were doing, what was going on. And I did a virtual show called Spoon River Anthology, which was Zoomed, and that was a lot of fun. It was nice to meet people because I made a new friend in New Jersey. And I still talk to Tim Flannery out there in New Jersey. But that was something we could do Zooming that, you know, we couldn't do here. I mean, you know, Ash Miller, she's up in Allentown. And Bill Eschbach, he's over in Fleetwood. And Kevin Wade is in Exeter. And we did a little silly comedy skit Zoom thing for BCTV that we did on the air one time. It's always an adventure to do something like that.
I think
live.
I'm gonna have to pull up that video, Pat. I'd like to see
okay.
That. I'll have to check the BCTV archives and find it.
Yes, you will. And because they put us on YouTube, you know, so we're always available if people want to look up old episodes of Greater Reading ACT UP or any of our little skits that we've done on the air and things like that. Trying to, you know, still keep our fingers in what we like to do in the middle of a pandemic. I was really grateful for Zoom, even though I know some people aren't crazy about it.
Well, think about it. The one benefit of Zoom is that you can now introduce, as you said, your production, your talents to people outside the area.
Yeah, and interact with them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, Tim and I would make an arrangement to get together 11 o'clock on a Friday morning and run lines and do a rehearsal. And that's what we do, you know. And then eventually with Spoon River, I just recorded everybody individually when they felt they were ready to perform. And then we had an editor, Andrew Pochin, put everything together so that it was like, it's like a little movie kind of a thing. So that was a lot of fun.
That's great.
Yeah, you can't do that necessarily. I mean, would have been nice if Tim could come to Reading, but he lives in New Jersey, so he's not going to come to Reading for rehearsals every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday,
right,
you know?
Right, yeah.
So, yeah. Oh, I'm very grateful for Zoom, even though I know some people say that they're tired of it. You know, I'm just glad that we had it for when we were really isolated.
Yes, yes, you're right. So, you're right about that.
Yeah, so now I'm looking forward to Saturday, and you're going to be there, I know.
Yes, of course. I look forward to meeting everyone and hearing more about the, again, the strategic initiatives and goals of the organization.
Yeah, and you'll get to meet some people that you didn't get to meet. We had a little meet and greet folks a while ago so that we could, Lori could meet the board, and a few members didn't make it, but you'll get to meet them on Saturday, and I'm looking forward to that. I think that it's going to be a good meeting and a good time and get a lot of good people together. And hopefully they'll be interesting in partnering with us, and we can all do more with more.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So wanted to thank you for coming on the show with me this new year in 2022. Let's hope it's a good year. Let's hope that everybody stays healthy and takes care of themselves. And offhand, I don't know of any shows coming up real soon, folks. So anyway, stay tuned. And we'll continue to let you know when we do about what's going on out there and sharing information with you. I want to thank BCTV for always hosting us and helping with this show. So Joan and John and Heather and English and Jordan, everybody over there at BCTV, thank you very much for all your help. So glad that you have a new studio to be in, more space, your own offices, which I'm sure you enjoy. And we're looking forward to doing more things with you guys. Thank you very much for joining us. And we'll see you next month. Take care, stay healthy and happy, and Happy New Year.
Greater Reading ACT UP on BCTV is supported by the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters.